Hi, everybody. Welcome to Configuration Management, a little bit about practical application of configuration management systems and how you really design one of these from a business perspective. My name is Mark Thomas here at Interface Technical Training, and for the next little bit, I'm going to walk you through a couple of stories and some examples of my experiences with designing and adopting a configuration management system. Now, configuration management, a lot of people think about this when you come out of, say, an ITO class. We have a process called service asset and configuration management. In a COBIT class, we have a process that we talk about called managed configuration. In PRINCE2, we talk about configuration of project products and those types of things. But I want to talk to you about what config really is all about in the next couple of slides. So before we jump further into going on the board and drawing some pictures for you guys, I want to make sure we all agree on what we're talking about as a description and a purpose for configuration management. Now, when we talk about config, we're not talking about configuration of just servers or just applications. We're talking about configuration items. And what is a configuration item? It is an asset or a document or an object that's required for the successful delivery of one of my services. So now I have to track and manage that asset or that configuration item. And I need to know two things about that configuration item. I need to know its attributes, right, the license plate data about it, and I need to know its relationships. It's relationships with other configuration items, because that configuration item could be a component of a larger configuration item. I may have a server that's a CI, and it's part of a facility that I might consider a CI. So there's a hierarchy that you might want to look at in how you identify and control and manage these configuration items. But the description of this is basically defining and maintaining the descriptions and the relationships between resources and capabilities required to deliver IT-enabled services. That's a key thing, because when we're looking at config, what is the service that we're actually delivering for our customer? And I'm talking about this from an IT perspective, okay? Because the business is not buying service from me, they're paying for services, and I need to make sure I know all the components that are required to do that. So we collect configuration information, we take baselines. A baseline, we take a snapshot of a configuration item or a configuration record in case we have to click the big undo button later on at some point. So now we make sure that we're tracking, we're auditing, verifying and auditing that information and updating this in a repository. What's a repository? Some people call this a CMDB, right? Well, if we have one CMDB, that's technically part of our config system. Now we can have more than one CMDBs. Now I'm not a technical guy, but we can federate these so that we can see how configuration items link to each other. So the purpose, therefore, is to provide sufficient information about the assets, the service assets, enable us to be basically managing those services effectively in the organization, okay? So again, we'll go into some drawings here on the board here in just a little bit, but I want to get through a couple of key components first. And this slide might be kind of hard for you to see, but I think it's very important to place configuration management as a process into the perspective of why this thing is important in an enterprise. So let's look at something called a goals cascade. Where I pulled this information, by the way, is from a process called COBIT. And one of the things that COBIT does is it takes this process called configuration and it says the process goal is this. Configuration repository is accurate, complete, and up to date. That's my goal. Make sure I have the right information. But that's great for the process. But what does that mean for us in IT? So let's link that process goal to some sample IT-related goals. So in order for me to meet some goals, I have to meet these. So make sure I have IT compliance. Well, clearly configuration is a core component to me being compliant. It also makes sure that I'm compliant not just for with my business needs, but also with external laws and regulations. Make sure that I'm optimizing my assets and make sure that I have availability of the resources. Those are the three IT goals that are supported by this process goal. And then you see, so we have some other goals up here. These would be really more of the business goals for IT, right? So you can see some of these. I'm just gonna pick out a couple of them that I think are important. Stakeholder value, obviously very important that we're talking about here. Compliance, again, the business requirements for IT here. Continuity and availability, making sure that we can make decisions in an organization, optimize our costs, and so on. And of course, compliance with our internal policies. So you see now that managing configuration is just not a technical process. There are IT goals and business expectations of IT that we have here. And finally, why do we even exist? Well, to meet stakeholder needs. You see on that last box, here are some sample stakeholder needs on why we have to have a process called config. How do we get value from IT? Are we satisfied with the quality of the service? How can I exploit new technology, improve business agility? Are my IT projects delivering what they're supposed to deliver? Okay, so you see there's some kind of neat things in here, and what I like here is the control requirements too. So configuration, you have to think about it outside of just the process on why it exists in the enterprise. And that goals cascade allows you to now look at those cascading reasons why the process exists. So I know that's very high level managerial kind of stuff, but I wanted to put that into context before we started taking a look at the key practices, some things that we have to do within configuration. Now, we've got some great bullet points here, but I'm going to step over to the board. I'm going to talk about my configuration management system in an organization that I was previously in. Now, I hear a lot of folks out there, and I've seen a lot of webinars and read a lot of papers, and people say configuration doesn't work. Nobody gets this stuff right. It is a complex project. It is a complex process. And so I'm going to walk you through kind of how we look through this. Now I will also say that in my organization, adopting this process called configuration management, we failed 3 times. And I'll tell you why we failed here in just a little bit. But it all started with director of my network services. Okay. So my director of my network services, these guys were great at Visio charts. Okay, they'd always come to meetings when we were talking about how things looked in the infrastructure, and they had a great Visio chart, but he'd have to circle something and say, well, that's changed, that's actually over here. So he'd have to redraw it on the piece of paper. And so we were challenged, we wanted live information. I want a snapshot of how all these things fit together as of recently. So he goes to my DBA and he says, okay, I've got these assets. And these assets, right, these are my network components. And of course, you notice that I said assets because configuration items are generally assets to begin with, right? So he has routers, switches, hubs, and those types of things. And what they did is he identified the information about each one of those assets, and he also identified the relationship between each one of those assets. And he asked the DBA, Susan, to put that into a little database for him. And they called that database a CMDB. Okay, this was great for him on the technical side. Still, it's doing nothing for me to meet any of my business goals, but it's great. Now he can have real live information and update this configuration management database with the attributes and the relationships of those components in the network. So far, so good. My server team. Server team says, hey, that was a great idea. Can we do the same thing? So guess what the server team does? Jesse goes to Susan and they make themselves a little database. And Jesse has an outline of all of his servers. Now, these are several different classes and several types of servers, virtual servers. We have Windows, we've got Linux, Unix, you name it, storage arrays, those kinds of things. So we had all these assets. And what they did is they identified the relationship between all these servers, how these servers connected with each other. Now, I'm not going to talk about the different types and styles of relationships, but you guys can get the idea. There are parent-child relationships, right? Information used as, used by, and those types of things. And guess what they created? They created a great little thing called a CMDB. Great for the server guy, still does me no good at the enterprise level. Well, to make a long story short, applications does the same thing. Applications and middleware, they said, all right, we've got applications, and they put databases in there, and so they identify these things. So the next thing you know, I've got 3 databases sitting out there, separate CMDBs. As you can imagine, I'm furious. It's great for you, but what has that done to meet IT-related goals, to meet business goals, and to help us satisfy our stakeholder needs? It's done nothing. We've spent a lot of money to help you do your job. So Susan, the DBA, says, hang on, you know, we can federate these. And so what she did was spectacular. She actually took these databases and she now linked them together. Now, I don't know how this happens. I'm not a technical guy, but she federated these databases and she can now make connections between these CIs and the databases.
Now she can make connections to here and here. She can make connections here and here, and so on. So now we're getting somewhere, but it's very technical in nature. So in the old days, right, when Jesse, manager of my servers, comes to my change advisory board, he says, I'm going to upgrade the operating system on this server right here. Well, in the old days, we sat in the cab. You've been at these. And everybody says, you good? Yep, I'm good. You good? Yep, yep, yep. And we approve that change to upgrading the operating system on that server. And on Monday morning, what happens? Well, not only is that server leaving a big smoking crater, I've got another server down here. I've got multiple issues down here. We haven't even talked services yet. Now we've got these infrastructure problems. Now what I've got the capability. When he comes in and says, I need to upgrade the operating system on that server, I can look into this system and see what other configuration items might be affected by that change. This is great. So have you ever gone to Google Earth? I love telling this story. If you go to Google Earth, you look at the globe, and what you see when you look at the globe, you see continents, huge configuration items, and you see how they're attached with oceans and waterways. You step into North America, now you see states and capitals, interstates, major roadways, and so on. Okay? You step into Arizona, you now see cities, local highways, smaller areas, and you step into Phoenix. You can step all the way in and see interface technical training, and you can see how this facility is connected to your facility through the use of sidewalks, roads, rivers, tunnels, dirt roads, and I can determine the best path from here to there. And what I can also do is I can put overlays on this. I can say, in my path, I want you to show me where all the gas stations are. I want you to show me the shortest path. I want you to show me the path with most construction, which is pretty much all roads in the state. So what I can do now is I can look at those overlays. You can do the same thing with your configuration management system. I can now see the connections between these configuration items. Again, this was a technical resolution. I haven't even talked services yet. So this is one of the reasons why we had failed, because we weren't providing any value to the organization, but we knew how our infrastructure was connected. It all came to a head. We had a priority one incident take place, and this priority one incident was around our virtualization VMs. So our service desk sends out an email to North America, and this email says, hey everybody, VM 0101 just went down, we're on it. This was a priority one ticket. Now what are you thinking when you're sitting in St. Louis, Missouri, and you get an email from the service desk that says, oh my gosh, we have a priority one ticket, VM 0101's down, we're on it. Does that mean anything to you? Nothing. So I start getting calls and calls. What's VM 0101? What does that have to do with me? Nobody knows. So I go to the service desk. Hey, what are you sending this information out? It's useless. And they said, well, we met our SLA because we had to respond within 5 minutes. We've got an issue here. I need to link that virtual machine or that server or that switch to a service. What I want is I want to send that email out, not to North America, but I only want to send it to the West Coast because the West Coast is the only region that's affected by this incident. And in that email, I want to say, hey, we've got a server down. It's affecting services A and B. Service A is completely done. We'll have it back up in 4 hours. Service B is intermittent. You can still use it, but the response is slow. Now that is an email that I'd like to receive. Well, I'd rather not receive the email in the first place. But if we have one, we'd like to be able to manage this. Well, how do I link these configuration items to services? Do I go out and manually populate one of these things with services? Aha, here's one of the things I have. If you've sat through, say, an ITO class or a COBE class service management type, you understand the idea of a service catalog. We had another database sitting out there, and that database is what we called our service catalog. In that service catalog, it contained a list. It contained the services, the operational services, or those that were available for use or upcoming, and now we can link those services into those infrastructure components. This was largely manual because we can't automatically detect what service a configuration item supports, because a service is very hard to find with, say, an auto discovery tool. I can't go out with an auto discovery tool and find wireless access, but I can find all the components that support that. So now I've got a different form of configuration item, these stars. Let's say these stars are services. That was service A.
Remember, service A is completely wiped out because of this incident. Well, now I've linked service into what other components are supported by that.
And we can now see those.
So now when that incident shows up, it may not be directly attached to that service, but because of the other relationships, I can now identify the impact of that VM being down. Now when I send an email out, I've got one of those pieces figured out, and that is how I communicate. Hey, service A is affected, service B is affected. There's another piece here that I don't have. Remember, I wanted to send that out only to the West Coast because the West Coast is the only region affected by that incident. I could also link in to other databases, my corporate databases. What I can do with my corporate databases is I can actually link offices, I can link regions, I could link individuals in some cases to that service. So now I've got corporate organization that I can link to these services. Now I've got the solution to be able to do. This stuff doesn't happen on a weekend. This stuff takes several weeks and months just to get, or years in some cases, just to get to this point where you can link these together. And it's not a project that you're ever really finished on, so it becomes operational. You have to continually improve this information, because if you have one tiny piece of data that is incorrect in this config system, what is the entire population going to think about the quality of that information? So you have to be on this. So we had a full-time team that actually helped us manage these pieces. So we've got these, this, I know this kind of looks messy, but you probably get the idea on this. Here's a question for you. Let's say you have a firewall that gets corrupted rules, okay? And you have to rebuild the rules in your firewall. Where do you find the rules for the firewalls? I'll tell you where you don't store those. You don't store firewall rules on a spreadsheet cleverly renamed family phone numbers 16 levels down in the P drive, okay? You want to have a secured location at which you keep information about these. Now you can have your security management system. Several different frameworks call them several different things, but you can now link your security information in here, and I can actually control access to that based on who needs to know and security levels. I can link those rules into a specific component. What happens when you're sitting at the service desk and you get a call? Somebody calls in and says, oh, the flux capacitor is broken. Well, I don't know what the flux capacitor is, but I can ask you a couple questions and I can find out what it is. And I say, oh, question number one, try this. You say no. Question number two, do this. You say yes. I say, oh, then we've got a known error and I've got a workaround. I'm going to send you an email and I want you to click on that link. I'll stay on the line while you're doing that. You click on the link. Now all of a sudden your flux capacitor works. I've just closed your incident. And what I just did is I applied a workaround to a known error. You might be thinking in the back of your head, what's that he's talking about? I'm talking about problem management. Now I've got another database sitting here that I can link in. And that database is what we call the known error database. Now I can associate known errors and workarounds with services and other infrastructure components. Let's say I have server maintenance contracts with vendors. I can actually have a supplier and contracts management system, another database, to link into this. And I can link an actual contract with a supplier or with a vendor to a specific piece of equipment or to a specific service or to a facility. So you see, this can become very, very huge. So when I say the Google Earth of all of my configuration items, that's exactly what we're talking about on these pieces. So you can see it's very important. So I've populated a bunch of databases out there. And I think it's important to kind of understand those things. But there are other areas, other things here that we can link into this config system. Our definitive media library. Where do you store official versions of your software? Right? They're considered assets. And I may have software that's linked to certain servers out there. So now I may have a DML, Definitive Media Library. We can link into that. One of the things that kept me up at night more than anything else as a CIO was software licensing compliance. We didn't know what we didn't know. What we could do is we could set up a monitoring tool that monitored how many licenses I owned of a certain technology in my DML. And it could also keep track of how many deployed versions of that software we had in my environment. And it could alert me using our event management process when we were about to reach a certain threshold to trigger us to procure more licenses. So we could also look at how we manage the security of these things through the rules and those kinds of things we talked about before. We talked about contracts. But each one of these configuration items we have has a configuration record to it. So picture this in your head. Picture you go into one, you want more information, just picture yourself either right-clicking on it or double-clicking on it. It's going to give you a configuration record. We call that the Carfax, okay? So now it gives me a complete history of everything that's happened to that configuration item. So if I want to do some type of analysis on how many incident tickets have been logged in which this configuration item has been involved in, I can now look at who my culprits are. We can look at this from when we're doing technology refreshes and those kinds of things as well. So we have to have monitoring tools. Another thing to think about is part of your event management or your monitoring and your operations roles. We have to have monitoring tools to watch these things. A monitoring tool could be classified as a configuration item. If that monitoring tool goes down, we're blind. I can't see the status of those CIs behind that. So there's so many pieces here that you've got. So you have to remember, this process needs to be managed formally. It needs to have ownership and leadership, policies and procedures, and the technical capability to be able to do that. Because now when we go through and we're starting to put this process with other processes like change management or release and deployment management, we can take a snapshot of these configuration items or a baseline. Have you ever had to go click the big undo button? Sure. When someone says, let's go back to the previous baseline, we can use this to be able to capture that information. It's very helpful for us to do that kind of stuff. Okay. Now, there are a lot of tools out there. What I'm explaining to you is kind of a hybrid approach to looking at this, and we actually built this ourselves. But we could link this into some of the more common service management tools. Most of the service management tools that we have on the market today have this capability to do that. What you're missing is the capability to be able to envision what you want and be able to link this to those services. That's where most people really get this thing upside down. I told you we'd failed a couple times. The first time we failed at this is because we had this great technology that allowed us to capture all this information, auto discovery stuff. But what we found was we discovered hundreds of thousands of moving parts. And we were overwhelmed very quickly because any time a change, modification, or adaptation in one of those CIs takes place, it has to be controlled through change management. My change management process was not capable of handling that large volume of changes. Remember, there's different types of changes that might come along in these things. We might have standard changes. Those are pre-approved. We've given you authorization to do that kind of stuff, okay? So an example of where we had that have an issue for us, and this is the thing for you to watch out for, because many people start getting into config and something doesn't go right and they say, doesn't work. This is what happened to us. We had to do a modification to a class of servers in one of our data centers. 40 servers in this particular class, and was approved through the change control board, because every one of those servers, based on my configuration records, looked exactly alike. That weekend, release goes in, 40 servers get modified, and out of those 40 servers, 32 of them reboot, 8 of them do not reboot. Well, of course, I'm a little bit upset about this, and nobody understands why. Well, 8 of those servers didn't reboot. We were told in our system that all of these things looked alike. Something was different about the configuration of those 8 servers. I want to know how this happened. Well, what we found out was in those 8 servers, one of our engineers had gone in and made some minor changes to those 8 servers. So I walk over and I'm getting ready to talk to this engineer. Why did you make those changes? And you can't do that because we had a change coming on these things. This engineer says, hey, hang on, lay off a second. I was doing standard changes. The CAB, the Change Advisory Board, has given me authorization to do these things. Aha, what we were finding was we weren't controlling this right. Now we went back and said, here's what we need to do. Let's say we're going to make a change to that server. What I can do is I can update the status of that server and kind of envision a virtual yellow sticky note on that server that says, keep your hands off, all bets are off. We got a change going on this server this weekend. Nobody touch it until next week or a certain date. Now I can put those those messages in place, I can make it even better. I can now remove your license to be able to change that configuration item from a standard change until we've gone through and done that change. That is the type of things you run into that nobody ever tells you until you drop a lot of money into this process. Don't give up. You'll find these things. Listen to some of the things I'm telling you. It will help you understand how all this stuff fits together. It's beautiful. So if I have an upcoming release, what I can do is I can go to all the configuration items that are affected by that upcoming release, and I can remove rights for standard changes on those, or I can put a note that says, don't touch. Now we're tracking the status of those CIs. Okay? So out of all those things I've just told you about, what are some of the key practices we have up here that support these things? Let's go back to the bullets and say, okay, have we done some of this stuff? All right, so what we did first is we made sure we established and maintained our configuration model. Our model, what are the hierarchy of configuration items? What is a configuration item, and how do we classify and package these things, and what are the relationships between them? Okay, we've got that. We've identified those in our policies, in our procedures. Establish and maintain a configuration repository and baseline. We've got a repository, multiple databases, I believe 29 databases in my complete system. But we did a baseline on those in case something happened, in case of a continuity event or before and after changes or releases took place. Got it. Maintain and control configuration items. We do this through my change management process. Remember, some of the changes to those CIs may be low risk, well understood, pre-approved changes, standard changes. You can do those unless I put some rules on those that don't allow you to do it temporarily. And we can manage those configuration items through the change process and keep track of them and do our status and accounting information for those things. Produce status and configuration reports. We talked about status and accounting there now. Right, we can look at the status. We can look at the when the last changes were done on these, and we can look at the overall status of this. Okay, verify and review the integrity of the configuration repository. Remember, we said here we have to have good information, because as soon as we start looking at this and we find out that the information we're looking at is not correct, then we think the entire data set is bad. We need to make sure that when that compass says north, I believe that is north and it's true and correct information. So you see there's a lot of data analysis that goes into this. So don't think this was just a DBA job. We had our information and our data engineers involved in this, our service management folks from the services side in this, security, contracts and procurement. This was a complete team effort on this, and it was a very, very big effort in order to get this config system put in place. But it requires care, and it requires a lot of maintenance to keep this alive in the future. So I hope that's been helpful. I know that the picture is kind of messy, but I wanted to walk you through. There are a lot of different ways which you can organize this. So you notice that I started, and again, we started at the technical layer because we had some specific technical challenges we need to take care of. Now, you can start at the service level. So you can start by service A and now say service A, and you can go through the technical layers and do it service by service, which in most cases is the preferred method because now you're focusing on the service first. So we did it backwards. It took us a little longer to get there, okay? And I told you that because we had so many failures, we wanted to start with easier configuration items first. We want to start with bigger components because we could later get into the smaller components or subcomponents of those, if you will. If you think about an engine's a component, a CI, but I also have a carburetor on it, it's a CI too, but it's a part of the hierarchy of that. So having that information accurate and complete is paramount for your success, okay? All right, so if you want more information, so there's a lot of stuff out there about configuration management in a lot of different frameworks. The ones that will give you the best, I believe, management perspective of configuration, number one is COBIT 5. You notice I put management practices up in the previous slide. Those were from COBIT 5. There is a process in it called BAI 10, which stands for Build, Acquire, and Implement. It's the 10th process. It's called Manage Configuration. In COBIT, it identifies The management practices, and under those practices, it gives a specific activities. It also gives inputs and outputs and a high-level RACI chart associated with managed configuration. The next one you see is ITIL 2011 has a process called service asset and configuration management. Now, they're combined. You have asset and configuration management. COBIT, by the way, has a separate process for assets, so that's separate. They're combined in ITIL. Although you can manage these as separate processes, the way we look at an ITIL is asset and configuration management. Why? Because I have assets, and if an asset is required for the successful delivery of a service, I now want to track that as a CI. What we found is by using this configuration management system, I did not have to have a separate asset management system. You know what I'm talking about. You've got the spreadsheets all over the place and people are trying to track assets everywhere you go. Now we combine those because I'm using the same system to be able to do this. So for example, I need to do an audit, a physical audit of assets. Here's another area where we caught a gotcha, if you will. The numbers aren't correct, but you'll get the story. We did an asset audit of PCs in one particular area, and there were supposed to be 300 PCs in this area. Well, the asset audit comes back, says, we're missing 50 PCs. 50 PCs are missing. Well, people don't steal PCs from us. What are these things? What had happened was we put such tight controls on access to changing records in this that our desktop support team would do a move at change, and they'd move a PC from floor A to floor B. And they weren't given the capability to change those that information, so they just changed it, and there we go. So 50 moves, now I have bad information. Another failure on our part. So that's why you want to think about all these possible scenarios, because once you get into this, you keep learning and you make sure you protect that data and information. So ITIL 2011, a great reference. It really, really talks about the service aspect of how we link and how services are affected by configuration items. So very valuable. You also have ISO 20000, ISO IEC 20000, which is the International Standard for Service Management. The process is called configuration management. A great checklist of shalls and shoulds along the lines of configuration management. So I think you'll kind of like those. There are all kinds of different ones. For example, in project management, we have a methodology that I've talked about called PRINCE2. Well, there's change in configuration management. What they're talking about is configuration records and versioning control. The same concepts apply when we're talking about project products as well. All right. Okay, so let's jump ahead, and I want to really talk in this last piece just about some suggestions and good practices that I think you should consider if you haven't picked any up already from my discussion that might help you out. So one, and I mentioned this before, protect the integrity of CIs and configuration items, change management. Configuration management will not work if your change management process doesn't work. I call it Mark's Law. In fact, there's probably a law out there that somebody else's name is on that too. Be very careful. Make sure change management is solid as a rock before you jump into this. So organizational policies on scope, requirements, and communication, all the things we've been talking about, the policies on change management, where, when, and how do we change the status of a configuration item that says, don't put your hands on this. Who gets access to certain configuration items in your system, and what access do they have? We wanted widespread access to view, because when you looked at this configuration model, you weren't seeing dots. We actually had little pictures of things, okay? So that you got a flavor of what they're talking about. So make sure that you have that and the communication around how we're communicating modifications and changes to policies and so on. So this next one's important because the cost of managing CIs must be validated, supported by a business case, and obviously by risk management. If this costs you more than it's worth, you're wasting organizational resources. And this initially happened to us because we were spending a lot of time and money on a lot of database work. And what we found was we couldn't link it back to services yet. And so therefore, it was just an IT project that did nothing for the enterprise. From the risk management side as well, right? Looking at the risk of those CIs and the risk of those kinds of things. Another thing that it really helped us looking at from the risk side was on security as well as our continuity strategy. It was very helpful for that as well, okay? Don't just focus on the technology. A lot of people love it. I hate it when we have a piece of technology or we have a solution looking for a problem. So don't go out and pick the technology first. Understand your model. Know who owns what, know what a CI is, how you're controlling these things, and then you can put the technology on top of that. Like I said before, most of the service management packages that exist today have this capability, plus or minus what we've just talked about here today. All right? Now, I love this one, link to a knowledge management platform. Now what we're talking about is, think about BI for IT, right? You've got a platform of BI where you have data, information, knowledge, and that becomes value. This configuration management system, or the CMDBs, should be a part of your knowledge repository or your knowledge space, okay? ITIL, it's called the SKMS, or Service Knowledge Management System. So make sure you link it in that, because where knowledge is very, very handy is for that person sitting at the service desk. The call comes in. I have no idea what they're calling about. I might find my answers here. I might find my known errors and be able to apply a workaround from you from that spot too. I might be able to understand where or what part of the organization is actually consuming these services based on this stuff. So it's a great link into your knowledge management platform to be able to do that. So think about that. So if you have a knowledge manager in your organization, make sure that you have a communication link between you and them on this, because that is providing value. And when we say exercise control to an appropriate level. So when we first started looking at CIs, the question was, well, hey, Mark, what's a CI here? Well, anything that moves. Well, now all of a sudden, we don't want to track CIs down to the NIC card level, okay? We want to make sure that it's appropriate. So we started big, and then as we got more mature, we figured out what the level of control we had to look at future and future iterations of this. Because when we say it's an appropriate level, remember there's amount of risk and there's amount of cost that comes with this. And if my change management process cannot handle the volume, then what we've just done is we've wasted organizational resources for an IT tool that nobody outside of IT gets any use of, okay? So some good points there, and I think you kind of get the idea on config. I hope I've been able to give you some good tips and tricks to be able to look at on this stuff. And if you have any questions or comments, now's probably a good time. We can jump through and be happy to entertain anything you might have now.